Join us as we answer the question, could we colonize Venus? Here are 10 reasons why we think we can. Number 10, Venus is closer. People want to put a colony on Mars, mostly driven by science fiction notions, but with less regard for facts. Mars is seldom close to Earth, and getting there is both difficult and problematic. If you could only go on vacation after more than 2 years, it might seem exotic and worth putting extra effort into it. If, however, it was a fixed 26-month vacation with no chance of going home early, getting to a hospital or a dentist, you might want to find a different travel agent. Worse yet, it takes at least 6 and possibly 9 months with current technology to get there and the same to return. We can certainly improve upon that number, but it's a long trip. At 23 million miles, Venus is a planet which makes the closest approach to Earth. Mars' closest approach is 35 million miles. The fastest probe to Venus took 109 days, but it usually takes about 125 days or 4 months. That's far better than the 6 to 9 months for a Martian journey. Admittedly, we can't launch to Venus whenever we feel like it. We have to wait about 19 months for the best path. But again, better than 26 months for Mars. Number 9. Getting high on Venus. The surface is hotter than a pizza oven, averaging 470 degrees Celsius or 880 degrees Fahrenheit, which is considerably hotter than needed to melt lead. Cloudy Venus reflects 60 to 75% of solar radiation, but remains excessively hot due to a runaway greenhouse effect because its atmosphere is about 97% carbon dioxide, instead of Earth's trivial 0.04%. In the 1960s, we used to speculate that Venus might be idyllic, with giant trees due to the 20% lower gravity. Clouds seemed to indicate that there might be lots of refreshing rainfall and storms that kept everything lush and green. A literal paradise. No. At over 90 times the atmospheric pressure of Earth, being on the surface of Venus is equivalent to living about a kilometer underwater here on Earth. We couldn't survive on the surface without a whole lot of gear. But that's not the only choice. You see, just like climbing Mount Everest, the higher you get, the thinner the air gets. It also gets remarkably cold. At about 30 to 40 miles up, well above the cloud layer, it has the same pressure and temperature of a nice day on Earth, roughly 70 degrees Fahrenheit or 21 degrees Celsius. Most people would find that quite comfortable. Number 8. Habitats that float. Carbon dioxide is 152% heavier than ordinary air, which is made up of nitrogen and oxygen for the most part. If we were to fill a balloon with air and put it in a room filled with CO2, it would actually act like a helium-filled balloon on Earth and bob along the ceiling. Applying that principle to gas bags holding up large platforms, we could easily build dozens, hundreds, or thousands of communities. They could all maintain height by adding or compressing air and support a surprising amount of weight. If we wanted to use helium, it would be a much more powerful lifting gas at 11 times lighter, but it's not terribly useful for anything else, and we'd have to import it. Hydrogen is another alternative and readily available in the atmosphere, and it's fairly safe since there's no free oxygen for it to burn with. Something we'll have to think about. The advantage of using Earth normal atmosphere is that you would have an enormous reserve since it's the gas you use to float the cities, a built-in safety factor. In any case, Venus has a ready supply of atmospheric nitrogen, much more than we have on Earth because the atmosphere is so much thicker. Sequestering carbon into solids would give us much more oxygen than we could ever use. We could manufacture as much atmosphere as we need from what's present. It's a win-win. Number 7. Acid clouds. It's true that the clouds contain sulfuric acid droplets, and so time spent outside would require a plastic coverall type suit and an air tank. On the whole, the temperature and pressure make it easy enough to cope with, and making equipment redundant and acid-proof should be no serious challenge. More importantly, H2SO4, aka sulfuric acid, has the hydrogen and oxygen we want to harvest. Together with the CO2, we can make useful hydrocarbons such as plastics and rocket fuels. You see, even acid clouds have a silver lining. Number 6. Solar power. Of course, there is sunlight in abundance, but making solar cells would be very useful to turn it easily into electricity. For that, we just have to look a bit below where the habitats usually float to find silver and gold-colored snowflakes made of some reasonable, rare, and useful metals. They circulate in a layer constantly going up and down with the atmospheric currents, specifically tellurium and iron pyrite, silver and gold-colored respectively, are ideal for making semiconductors. Iron pyrite is strongly proposed as the best base for thin-film solar cells. When you have virtually unlimited power, you can accomplish nearly anything. Moving habitats around so that the various communities or cities could trade specialty goods, technicians, cargo, or inhabitants would be easy and cost-free, powered by electric motors. Number 5. Movement and transport. Getting from one habitat to another could be accomplished by electric plane, blimps, and gangways. In groups of permanently fixed balloons, they might have permanent bridges with electric vehicles built inside the balloons themselves. Getting from a mining operation on the surface to an orbiting transport would be economical because all you have to do is inflate a balloon to lift cargo. Getting it from the upper edge of the atmosphere to the ship could be done with a small booster or skyhook. Number 4. Terraforming Venus. Living in the upper atmosphere would allow us to take centuries to casually transform Venus into a great place to live. We could build orbital shades to decrease solar radiation significantly. Without the steady supply of excessive heat, Venus would begin to cool, and the CO2 would begin to liquefy to form vast seas. The atmospheric pressure would drop too, of course, so the habitats would need to increase buoyancy to stay afloat. Over time, we could land on the surface with lots of protective gear and live, but it would be difficult and still take centuries before we could actually make it into an Earth twin. Planets don't lose heat fast enough to do it any quicker than that. Eventually, much of the CO2 would solidify into dry ice, leaving a largely nitrogen atmosphere, which would be really useful for any other colonies to create atmospheres. Number 3. Radiation. A magnetosphere is the area of space around a planet that's controlled by the planet's magnetic field. On Earth, our magnetosphere deflects the solar wind, protecting our atmosphere from erosion. Mars has no magnetosphere now, and its atmosphere is essentially gone. We rely on ours to protect us. Venus has a minimal magnetosphere because of its smaller size and slow rotation. The convection of its molten core moves too slowly to generate a powerful magnetic field. What serves to protect Mars from radiation from the Sun and the equally hard radiation that just comes from space generally? Interestingly enough, Venus has a secret weapon called an induced magnetosphere. Due to the thickness of the atmosphere and the influx of ultraviolet radiation, the upper atmosphere becomes heavily ionized. This means it has a thick ionosphere with a massive electrical charge, much more powerful than Earth's ionosphere. The solar wind also has an electrical charge. Just like our magnetic effects, these two electrical forces repel each other, steering the solar wind around the atmosphere, preventing erosion. Venus's induced magnetosphere trails off like a long tail pointing away from the Sun. Number 2. No water. Venus has massive granite formations on the surface, a type of rock that forms in the presence of water. But Venus's water boiled off long ago as it became hotter and hotter. Water was too light to stay below the induced magnetosphere, so it was swept away by the solar wind. Without water, it was difficult to sequester carbon, as happened on Earth in the form of carbonates, so the carbon oxidized to CO2 and accumulated. We could theoretically import water to Venus by redirecting comets to crash on the planet. Comets are made of ice, dust, and rocky material, and some scientists speculate comets and asteroids were actually the source of water for Earth. Also, if we aimed it right and kept that up for decades, we could bash away at the equator, adding kinetic energy until we shortened the current 243 Earth day long Venus day to just 24 hours. But crashing into the surface would add a lot of heat and slow down the terraforming process even further. Number 1. I Will Survive. Gloria Gaynor sang the song I Will Survive back in 1978, and the lyrics include being back from outer space. And did you think I would just lay down and die? For the most part, humans try to survive even in the most dire circumstances. The current problem is that every human alive is within 400 kilometers of the planet. So one big unexpected rock can take out all of us. In the last few years, we've had rocks big enough to take out a city, which luckily happened to explode high in the atmosphere, doing limited damage on the ground. We won't always be this lucky. Eventually, we need to get a large group of humans off the planet and living independently, whether on the Moon, Mars, Venus, or even in orbiting space cities. If you had to pick, would you rather live on Venus or Mars? Let us know in the comments below, and then check out this next video that you might find really interesting.